Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Happy to be here. This is always a treat to come to New Kent and be with you folks and lead worship. Most of you know who I am. I'm Deacon Bolt of the KOG of Williamsburg. And as things happen for the last going on 3 years now, I've been half of my time is spent at Nazareth in New Hope. And it's the other side of the river. And I didn't have to drive as far this morning.
There you go.
That's a plus. And it's exciting, you know. This church is like just on the cusp of really blooming and becoming your next evolution. So I congratulate you, and I look forward to seeing the new building one of these days. What else I was going to say? This is a strange coincidence. Very strange, but 3 years ago, almost to the day, I was here preaching because Pastor Larry was on vacation, I believe. He asked me to come and fill in, as he did this week. And it was July 23rd of 2021. Yeah, 2021, July 3rd. The gospel reading was exactly the same. And I didn't realize it until after I'd written the sermon for this morning. I said, wait a minute, this whole shepherd thing, this sounds familiar. I know I did this one. You know, I'm looking through my old sermons to see if I did it at Nazareth. There was a church in Hampton that I was doing for a year. And no, it was this church. And fortunately, it's a much longer sermon than I did 3 years ago. So you catch a break today. And it was proven conclusively, because there's a lot of sheep in this sermon. A lot of shepherds, a lot of sheep. But it was proven conclusively that my knowledge of sheep is minimal at best. Okay, I'm a city boy from New York. No, sheep is not our vocabulary. But anyway, I remember distinctly last time there were a few members here who had some experience with sheep, and they filled me in on some of the background and what I could expect if I decided to be a shepherd later in my life. So we share the peace of Christ together.
She's going.
That one's good.
That's the great thing about a small congregation. It's intimate enough that you can say, wish God's peace to everyone. I know I missed something.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We gather as God's people to worship Him, receive His gifts of grace, and to celebrate our new life in Christ Jesus. Yet as we gather, we know that we are sinners in need of repentance and forgiveness. Scripture tells us that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Confident in God's grace, let us confess our sin to God, our loving Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Hear the good news for you today. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son, Jesus, to die for us, and for His sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, He gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. God's word of promise declares to us that we are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
With you.
And also with you.
O God, powerful and compassionate, you shepherd your people faithfully, feeding and protecting us. Heal each of us. Make us a whole people that we may give witness to the joy of our life in the risen Christ.
We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you, Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Fellow children are invited to go to children's church now.
Is Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 1-6. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who care not for my people, who care for my people. You have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. Behold, I will attend to you for your evil deeds, declares the Lord. Then I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all of the countries where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will set shepherds over them who will care for them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall any be missing, declares the Lord. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will dwell securely. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second lesson today is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who are far off and peace to those who are near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The apostles returned to Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. And he said to them, "Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. As they went away in the boat to a desolate place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they ran there on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. And when he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And when it grew late, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a desolate place, and the hour is now late. Send them away to go into the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But he answered them, "You give them something to eat." And they said to him, "Shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give it to them to eat?" And he said to them, "How many loaves do you have? Go and see." And when they had found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then he commanded them all to sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups by hundreds and by fifties. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples to set before the people. And he divided the 2 fish among them all. And they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces and of fish. And those who ate the loaves were 5,000 men. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? Well, Jesus began one of his parables that way. At another time, he said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Well, today's gospel text, Jesus is not telling a story about a shepherd. He's not calling himself the shepherd. Rather, we see him being the shepherd, acting as the shepherd, acting as he truly is. The Holy Spirit, through the words Mark wrote, reveals to us our Savior's shepherd heart. And his shepherd heart goes out to the sheep. Sheep that are shepherdless without him. This is a lot of sheep in one sentence. They are his first concern. They are his priority. He gives them real life. He gives them real food as he teaches them and as his voice calls out to them. And friends, his heart goes out to each one of us as well in the same way. And that's the theme to meditate on this morning. The shepherd's heart goes out to you, and he makes you his first concern. Yeah, that's going to be contagious if I start hearing that. So that's part one. That we are his concern is part one. And he takes care of you as his voice teaches you. That's part two. He is your shepherd, and that means for all of us. For all of us sheep. Now, as I said before, my knowledge of sheep is really minimal. You know, I see them on TV. There's this, but you do learn some things. You do pick up some things from your surroundings. When we first moved from New York to Williamsburg, we had to wait in a hotel on Pocahontas Trail for our closing date, which was like 2 or 3 days. So we were camped out in that hotel with our two dogs. We had to pick a hotel that allowed dogs, of course. And so one day we were out walking the dogs, and right across the street was the meadow that Colonial Williamsburg has for all of their sheep, right? And they were laying up against the fence, munching on grass. But one of them in particular was right up against the fence. His head was actually sticking through. I say his head, I don't know if it was a male or a female sheep. But the head was sticking through, and we walked up with these two dogs, two aging, geriatric dogs, who had also never seen a sheep. Okay? As far as we know. So we walked up, and the first dog is kind of a mutt, and she sniffed that sheep, and she decided she wanted no part of it. Not at all, was not interested at all in that sheep. Just walked away. The other dog was a long-haired dachshund who, and if you know anything about dachshunds, they are killers. They're very aggressive sometimes. And he walked up, took a sniff at the sheep, and decided lunch. Went like that. Now, of course, he only got a mouthful of wool, you know, because that's what was that sheep was composed of mostly. But that was one of the things that I learned about sheep, was that they will sit there and let you bite them if they're necessary. The other thing I learned about the sheep was the thing that my one dog decided, which was that I want no part of this. this was some stinky animal. So as we join Jesus in the text, the disciples are returning from the mission trips he sent them on. If you remember from from previous weeks that Jesus has sent his disciples out two by two to all the surrounding area. He told them, don't take any money, don't take any food, don't take any extra clothing. Just go out there, and I give you all authority. You know, the demons, you have authority over demons, over diseases. And that's what they do. They go out, and they come back, and they are just like overjoyed and excited. You know, they can't even contain themselves. They want to talk about it. They want to tell Jesus about it. You wouldn't believe it, Jesus. We would say a word and people would get up from their sick beds, cured and healed. You know, we cast out demons. We had authority over them. They heard our voices and would flee. And Jesus right away knows you guys need to decompress. So he tells them, says, let's go to a quiet place, to a deserted place, where we can sit and we can talk and we can pray, and maybe you can get a bite to eat. You know, because even finding time to eat has been a challenge for these disciples. So Jesus tells them, come away with me to a quiet, secluded spot where they shouldn't be bothered. There they can rest, and there he can teach them privately. So they get in the boat. A lot of the disciples have a background in fishing, so then right away they get into a boat to cross over to the Sea of Galilee to the shores that are less populated. But as they get in the boat, the crowds are spot them, and they run along the shore. They go from town to town as they sail past and row past each town. More people as they hit each town, more people come out of the towns and fill up this crowd until by the time they get to where they want to, they are surrounded by people. And so, what does Jesus do when he's confronted with this situation where he has so many people waiting for his every word? Words of healing, words of teaching. Well, he can't really look at his calendar and say, oh, I have a spot open next Thursday where we can all meet. He doesn't just give them one of these and tells them to go on their way and so forth. It says that he has compassion on them. He feels deeply for what they feel. He feels how helpless they are. He feels how put upon they are. And shepherdless sheep are easy prey for any predators, wolves, coyotes. A friend of mine up in Hopewell, he and his wife have a kind of a farm. He calls it a farm. I would have called it a ranch, I guess, because he's got cattle on the ranch. That's what he does. He raises cattle. And what he has to do is every once in a while, he has to call in what he calls a vermin specialist. And the guy goes out at night with his night vision goggles and his high-tech rifles or whatever, and he goes after the coyotes because coyote will take a calf very easily. And that's his business, and that's his livelihood, so he doesn't want to lose any calves, so he has this professional hunter going out to take care of the coyotes. Because, like the sheep, they can't outrun the coyotes. They cannot fight them. And if you think about it, a wolf or a coyote or a lion or whatever other predators there were at that time, would any of them have been frightened off by, you know, and so without a shepherd protecting, guiding, keeping the predators away, the sheep would be left torn and bloody and dead. In addition, shepherdless sheep, they can overgraze pasture. They can eat the grass so far down that it doesn't recover, it doesn't grow back up again. And so if they don't have anybody to guide them, they will stay in that same pasture until they starve to death. Thirdly, unbelievably, shepherdless sheep can even die because of their own filth, because of their own anatomy, I guess. There's things get stuck in their wool. They get attacked by blowflies who burrow in. They lay eggs, and there's maggots coming out of the sheep. So it sounds really appetizing, right? A fly-blown sheep is a sickening sight, which shepherdless sheep are. And that's exactly what Jesus saw. That's exactly why his heart went out to these people. For they were like sheep without a shepherd. And those people that he saw, those crowds that he saw, were more important to him than a time of rest. They were more important to him than letting his disciples decompress and tell their stories of what happened on their mission trips. It's more important than even having a snack and getting something to eat. The shepherd's heart goes out to them. He makes them, those people, his first concern before himself. And that shepherd's heart, that concern, that willingness to make these people his priority, that same heart goes out to all of us. For without him, we are shepherdless sheep. Without him, we fall prey to the predators of this world. Satan's teeth tear us to shreds with his lies and deceptions, and we need a shepherd. We need our shepherd. Without him, we starve to death, unable to find the green pastures that restore our souls. Like the dusty, dirty dirt of overgrazed land, the empty promises and the senseless pleasures of this world can't bring true nourishment or life. We need our shepherd. Without him, the filth of our own sin clings to us. We need our shepherd. And what great good news that his heart goes out to us. No matter who we are or what we've done, we are still his first concern. He doesn't send us away to wait for a better time, a more convenient time. He doesn't wait for us, this is an important one, he doesn't wait for us to meet his standards. While we were still sinners, he called each and every one of us. His heart goes out to us as we are, no matter how torn or starved or fly infested we are. His heart goes out to us to make you, us, keep in his flock. His heart goes out to us to change us, to be more and more like him, our shepherd, because we are his first concern. Now, I'm going to use a different metaphor, because I'm a little tired of the sheep thing. But consider a new mother, home alone with her baby, and suddenly she's awakened by the smell of smoke. The house is on fire, and her only thought is for her child, for her baby. She races down the smoke-filled hall without a thought for her own safety. She grabs him in her arms. She shields his face from the flames with her hands, unmindful of the pain and the sting and the flames, because her baby is her first concern. We are Jesus' first concern. We are his priority. The shepherd's heart goes out to us. He left the brightness of his Father's side for us to come into this world filled with the smoke of our sin. He came to rescue us. And on the cross, he endured the fires of our hell, those hopeless, God-forsaken griefs and pains and terrors, all of them unimaginable to us. He endured it willingly for us, for we are his first concern. You are no longer shepherdless sheep. We are no longer shepherdless sheep. Jesus is our shepherd. He laid down his life for us. Yes, for us. And yet he's taken it up again. as our living shepherd. He takes care of us. He takes care of us as his voice teaches us, which brings us to the second part of that meditation this morning. Consider Jesus' actions as a shepherd, as his heart goes out to the people. What does he do? Mark writes, when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. That was his first priority. Not to feed them, not to heal them, to teach them. To teach them many things. He taught them. And that's how he takes care of his sheep, by teaching them his word. And that's how he takes care of us. His shepherd voice teaches his words of truth. And what comfort and care his voice brings. What comfort and care his voice brings to us as we listen to his voice calling out to us from Scripture, teaching us his word of truth. He cut away the filth that we had soiled ourselves with. He pulls out the maggots of guilt. And he says to us, I, Jesus, your shepherd, have taken away all your sins, washed you clean in my blood, for I lay down my life for you, my sheep. You are fully forgiven. Be of good cheer. And so we can listen to his voice, for only his word brings you this good news. He faced down Satan, that ravenous predator, that prowling lion, with his truth. And he continues to protect you from Satan's lies and deceptions. His voice calls to you, fear not, little lamb, only hold on to my word of truth. It will not fail. For I, your shepherd, have taken up my life again in victory. Follow me. Listen to my voice, for my word of truth protects you. And he feeds you with the green pastures of his word. He brings you life and nourishment through his teaching. His voice invites you, come, all who hunger and thirst for righteousness, come drink the living water flowing from the Scriptures. Come feast on this life-giving food, which is the only food that truly satisfies. Come and be filled. And as you inwardly digest the word, thinking about it, meditating on it, making it a part of you, you are changed. And I would venture to guess that almost everyone here could tell that same story, how Scripture has changed us from who we were to who we are. The shepherd's heart went out to you in the pitiful condition you were in as a shepherdless sheep. But praise God, he doesn't keep us that way. He changes us. He transforms us. And the word changes our natural wants so that we more and more truly want what our shepherd wants for us. He says to you, my sheep, listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life. And today his voice speaks to us in the most intimate and tender way he has given us in this earthly life. Today his voice speaks to you through his body and blood in the Lord's Supper. He's speaking to us. His voice whispers his forgiveness into our ear. You are mine. Here is my body given to death for you. Here is my blood shed on the cross to ransom you. You are my lamb, and I am your shepherd. Shepherd's heart goes out to each and every one of us. And may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please stand as we confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into heaven. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Please be seated. Receive our offerings today. Receive the offerings of our time, talent, and treasure. We give them to you with grateful and thankful hearts in response to your abundant love. We pray that you would use them as you use us each day, that all will know the love of Jesus. In his name we pray.
Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. We bless you, Lord, for you have sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from sin, death, and the power of the evil one. Your gracious love for us is shown most clearly in his death and resurrection. In him, we are given new life. Give us the courage to proclaim through our life and witness the good news of our salvation, which is found in him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, give wisdom to our president, governor, county administrator, and all elected officials. They will honor your purpose, protect your people, serve the cause of justice, and defend our liberty. We also pray for protection for candidates and guidance for us as we continue in the campaign and electoral process. Lord, in your mercy,
Amen.
We lift to you, Lord, those who serve in law enforcement, especially Sheriff Lee Bailey, Deputy Keith Jenkins, and all who serve in the new Kent Sheriff's Department, in all departments throughout our land. We pray for judges, legal teams, all who serve in the court system. We pray also for firefighters, EMS workers, doctors, nurses, and medical teams. Bless them all as they serve. Lord, in your mercy, guide and protect the men and women who defend our freedom and liberty in the military, both here and abroad. We especially remember Dylan as he serves. Bless and sustain them and their families as they serve. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We come to you today to pray for those we love, our family and friends who are in need of prayer today. Hear their names as we bring them before you in this place. Lord, you know the needs of all these people. We pray that you would bring healing, strength, comfort, hope, and peace as you meet them in their need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, may your spirit lead us to live in thanksgiving to you as we share the hope, joy, and peace that is ours in Christ Jesus, who is risen from the dead for us. Help us to share the good news that all will know his love. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
If you read your bulletin, you know that Pastor Larry, before he left, consecrated these elements for our use today. And just asked me to repeat the words of our Lord. That Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he was given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is the cup of the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you. Please stand. Lord Jesus, your true presence has come to each of us in your word and sacrament, and we give you thanks and praise. We pray that we might go out into the world as your people, your church, proclaiming your love.
Strengthen us as your people, connected to you by your Spirit, that we may grow in faith and love to share the good news of Jesus as we live in him. Amen.
As God's people, we proclaim,
now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. And the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Peace to love and serve the Lord.
That all may know the love of Jesus. Thanks be to God.